And I'm happy to welcome you to this Beyond the Headlines event featuring Imam Feisal Abdul Rauf and his new book, Moving the Mountain, Beyond Ground Zero to a New Vision of Islam in America. Explaining his title, Imam Feisal writes, this book seeks to move a mountain of suspicion, myth, fear, and hatred, and provide a new vision of Islam in America and the world. Imam Feisal came to this country in 1965, became an American citizen in 1979, and in 1983, a sheikh in a Soho mosque that he frequented often gave him a symbolic gift that meant that he was ready to become the imam of that mosque. Looking at the life he has led since then, the gift certainly turned out to be prophetic. It was not a spiritual amulet. It was not prayer beads. It was not a white cap or a shawl, the kind of thing you might have expected at that moment. It was a roll of Tums, the antacid pills you take to relieve heartburn, and how he would need them. For a long time, he had his critics who found him suspect as an agent of America and an apologist for Israel because he advocated the United States abroad, sometimes on tours and meetings sponsored by the U.S. State Department. But then in 2010, he sought to create a 15-story Muslim community center called Cordoba House with a mosque in it near Ground Zero, and he instantly became a lightning rod in the polarized American national debate. Suddenly, he wasn't an accommodationist with the West anymore, but a crypto-jihadist bent on the West's downfall. The project was condemned as an act of insensitivity, even a monument to terrorism, and it became a flashpoint for all the unhealed wounds of 9/11, and in some cases for opportunistic Islamophobes. First, a little history on his fascinating life. Born to Egyptian parents in Kuwait and educated in England and Malaysia, Imam Feisal came to New York, as I said, in 1965. He was 17 years old. His father ran the Islamic Center of New York, and he had early exposure to the Quran and to religious debate, typing his father's thesis, his speeches, his lectures, his radio talks, his sermons. His family lived over its small mosque in a brownstone on West 72nd Street, serving mainly Arabs and African-American converts. But he was used to an environment where being a Muslim came naturally and came unquestioningly. In the 60s, by contrast, New York, as he notes in the book, was all about sex, drugs, and rock and roll. I'm trying to suppress a nostalgic grin. So he had to struggle to secure his Muslim identity. He studied physics at Columbia and managed to maintain links with Jewish students during the 1967 war, trying to understand their concerns. As I mentioned, he was asked to lead a Sufi mosque. I'm going to mispronounce this. Masjid al-Farah, how's that? Thank you. Then in Soho, but which since 1985 has been on West Tribeca, on West Broadway in Tribeca. I mention that because I want to point out the fact that when the 9/11 hijackers attacked the World Trade Center, they struck his neighborhood. His book is instructive and insightful, and by the way, it's for sale at the door. And Imam Feisal will be here afterwards to sign books when you buy them. I want to let him tell you about his book himself, but in closing, let me just point to one significant part of it which focuses on the freighted subject of Sharia law, its image in the West, and the fear that its invocation stirs here. When I wrote in the invitation that Imam Feisal, quote, insist on the relevance of Sharia law for democracy in America, unquote, a colleague of mine, trying to be helpful, thought it sounded so contradictory that she asked if I had accidentally left something out. In fact, I hadn't, and it is one of the many instances in this book and in his life work where Imam Feisal Abdul Rauf frontally takes on Western misunderstandings and misgivings about Islam. Imam Feisal, IPI is delighted to have you here, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Warren. Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here and to see a number of very familiar faces of friends in the audience. Thank you for having me, and I'm very happy to be at the IPI. And I've had good experience in the past with IPI, and I look forward to working with you on a number of initiatives that you're working on, such as election monitoring and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. I wrote this book, in fact, a result of, during the height of the crisis, I was invited by, this is a letter from Random House saying, if you ever want to write a book, we'll be happy to consider it. Eventually, it wasn't Random House that got it, it was Free Press, an imprint of Simon & Schuster, that actually inked the deal with me. But the purpose of the book, as my editor at Free Press said, they wanted this to be my calling card to Americans. They said, everybody saw you on television during the crisis. You know, they've heard all kinds of things about you, much of which is untrue. And they wanted this to be how I introduced myself to the United States, my calling card to Americans, and to be built around my story. I had never written anything like this before, Warren, so this one was a totally new experience. But thank God it was a very enjoyable experience, and I hope a successful one. I talk about a number of issues that that are on the minds of many, many people. But the major theme of this book, or one of the key themes about it, is the congruence between Islamic values and Christian values and even secular humanistic values. People think that Islamic ethics, Islamic values, is fundamentally opposed to the so-called Judeo-Christian values of the United States of America, or that it is something that is so alien and at odds. The fact of the matter is the exact opposite. Islam sees itself as the continuation of the Jewish and Christian tradition. In fact, a reading of the Quran does not depict Islam as being the religion of Muhammad, which is a myth that even Muslims have. It is really, it's really about God's religion. And read the Quran, the message of the Quran is that God has a religion which he revealed through various prophets. And just as Christians or Jews don't regard Solomon and David and Job as coming with different religions, but rather coming with the same tradition of reminding people about one God, we also are taught in the Quran to regard all of the prophets, including Jesus and Moses, who are our prophets, as part of a tradition of introducing God's religion. And we share the same values and the same commandments. In fact, one of the starting points of one of my chapters is that when Jesus was asked by a Jewish person, what is the greatest commandment? And he said, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord thy God with all of your heart, your soul, and your strength. And the second commandment, which he said is equal to it, is to love thy neighbor as thyself. What most Christians don't know or don't remember is that the very next verse in Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, is that upon these two commandments, Jesus adds, hangs all of the law and all of the prophets.
Apparently some people aren't hearing. Miko, is somebody here who can just adjust?
Is this better?
Yeah.
I'll hold this right here.
All right.
So upon these two commandments, Jesus adds, hangs all of the law or all of the prophets. And in fact, upon these two commandments of loving the God, loving our Creator, and loving our neighbor is the basis of even Islamic law. Muslims, so this is one of the themes of the book. But the other thing that I mention is also how when religion travels from country to country, it expresses itself in the cultural and institutional context of each country. So just as in Christianity, for example, when Christianity spread from Palestine to Egypt, then to Syria, then to Greece, then to Rome, and throughout the rest of Europe, you had the Coptic Church, which means the Egyptian Church in Egypt. You have the Greek Orthodox Church in Greece. the Roman Catholic Church in Rome, the Dutch Reformed Church in Holland, the Anglican Church in England. And when I was in Scotland, I think last year, yes, we have the Scottish Presbyterian Church, I was told. So, and the Italians don't think of Christianity as a Palestinian religion. They think of it as an Italian religion. And Alex, the same thing has happened in our history. When Islam spread from Arabia to the ancient civilizations of Egypt, of Byzantium, which is modern Turkey, of Persia, which is modern Iran, of India, it expressed itself in these cultures in every aspect, in law, in culture, in architecture, in music, in literature, even in calligraphy. So much so that even if you go to any of these countries today, the Turks, for example, my brother Ufuk here, Ambassador Ufuk, is from Turkey, the Turks don't regard Islam as an Arab religion. They think of it as a Turkish religion. So do the Iranians. They don't think of, and the Iranians, you know how they regard the Arabs. They don't think of Islam as being an Arab religion, think of it as an Iranian religion. The same thing in Egypt, the same thing in Senegal, the same thing in Pakistan. There was no Pakistan 70 years ago. But today, Pakistanis think of Islam as a Pakistani religion. So one of the themes that I say we have to do as Muslims in America is to evolve what I call an American Islamic identity. And I unpack what it means in this book in terms of law, in terms of culture, in terms of institutions. And this journey is a journey that even our predecessors, immigrant faith predecessors in America or to America, went through. When the Catholics came to this country, they were under fierce attack. Their churches were burned. And, you know, many of you who are of my generation will remember that when John Kennedy became president, many Americans were saying, oh my God, you know, we're now going to be under the thumb of the Pope. The Pope is going to run, American policy. And when Jews came to this country, they were also victims of all kinds of racism and oppression and regarded as alien. But it took 2-3 generations typically for an American Jewish identity to evolve, an American Catholic identity to evolve. And the importance to me is that the role of, when I look at the history of what the American Catholics did, and the American Catholic bishops, for example, played a very important role in redefining the relationship between the United States and the Vatican. It was the Roman Catholic American Catholic scholars like John Courtney Murray and the bishops here of America who actually who helped bring about Vatican II and brought the Vatican to a point where they embraced the American notion of separation of church and state, which the Vatican did not subscribe to until Vatican II in 1965. And so with the American Jewish community, that played a very important role as interlocutors between America and the global Jewish community. So it is definitely in the cards for the American an involvement of a robust American Islamic community that sees itself as naturally and culturally and institutionally American, as well as Orthodox Muslims in the deepest sense of the term. Of authenticity will play a very important role in mediating between the United States and the Muslim world at large. And this is something which I believe is already happening, but we need to encourage its evolution. So with these opening remarks, I'd like to sort of like end right here and go into the conversation and the questions from the audience, because that I think is what will be more interesting.
Absolutely. Let me, on that point you just made right now, it's a fascinating point in the book, that actually American Muslims, Muslim Americans, are in a position to be almost the proselytizers for the idea of Islam coexisting, cohabiting peaceably with democracy. And you just mentioned it right now. I wanted to ask you, what kind of response are you getting from other American Muslim leaders? Are they eager to take on that, or are they so burned by what happened to them in the aftermath of 9/11 that they are holding back?
Well, I mean, both elements always exist. I mean, the reality in the world is always a dynamic one. I mean, in any situation, any questions, you always get, you know, people who are on the left and on the right on any issue. But by and large, the American Muslim community is very much supportive of this idea. And when I began to float the notion of the need to develop an American Islam or an American Islamic identity, it has been very much embraced and recognized as being an important part of what we need to do in this country.
In the book, you talk about the fact that the word moderation in English means compromise. It can be a balancing between, sort of a weak balancing between two strong positions. And you say in Arabic it means something quite different.
Yes, the term wasatiyya in Arabic is a word in the Quran, actually. And it's interesting that in the second, which is the longest chapter in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, the very middle, it is 286 verses, the 143rd verse, which is exactly the midpoint. God says in the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا, we have made you a moderate nation, or another word is I'm blanking on, but it means non-extremist, or even a middle of the road nation, that you may be a witness over people, and that God may be a witness over you. And Muslim scholars have written about this concept of wasatiyya as meaning moderation, and they've also quoted sayings of the Prophet, in which the Prophet condemned those who were extremist. In fact, the Prophet has said in a number of his so-called ahadith, which means the sayings of the Prophet, he advised his followers not to be extreme in their practice of the religion, because that was what made their predecessors get derailed from authentic religiosity.
And I think your point was the word moderate in Arabic actually is a stronger word than it is in English. It's not compromise. It's not weak. It is a
very definite concept which has been written about and developed by Muslim theologians. I mean, and they quote many other sayings of the Prophet, like Khar al-Umur al-Wasat, the best way of approaching something is to be moderate. Moderate in your exercise, moderate in your food intake, moderate in your even in your religiosity. It doesn't mean that you are not passionate. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that you don't enjoy eating. Moderation means not to overeat, not to overdo something. Because when you overdo something, you actually spoil it. It's like when I first learned to cook and I add a little spice, oh, that tastes so good. So, you know, you think that the more you add of something, the better it'll keep getting. But the point is you can actually overspice your food or oversalt your food. So knowing the right balance, the right proportion of things is where perfection lies. Perfection does not lie at the end, but it lies really in a centrist position.
Everybody to whom I've mentioned that you were coming here has asked me, so what is happening with Cordoba House?
It's still a work in progress. The vision is still alive. And the idea of a space where all people of all faith traditions can come together and learn about each other and build understanding and mutual respect as a platform to establish peace. I mean, after all, you're a peace institute. What does peace mean, and how do you build peace, especially in the context of existing conflicts, is what this is all about. And it starts with people understanding each other. And through understanding, I mean, you know, there's a famous saying, to know someone is to love someone. And when you know someone and you get to know them and you eat together and you talk together, develop friendships, this is how you build relationships. And it's on these relationships that that coalitions are built, and that we can then together work around common causes. Which is why I also say that the real battlefront is not between Islam and the West, or Muslims and Jews, or Muslims and Hindus, etc. The real battlefront is between the moderates of all the faith traditions against the extremists of all the faith traditions. Because the extremists really have the same mindset, the same attitude of superiority, of exclusivity, think that they have the truth, and anybody who does not agree with them should be attacked or should be marginalized, whether you are a believer or even if you are even the atheist extremists, like the communists, you know, didn't brook any opposition to them, and any opposition was deemed heretic or heresy, and therefore your life was dispensable. This mindset is fundamentally at odds with the very meaning of being human, and what God has given us in terms of our individual freedoms. I mean, God says in the Quran, had God willed, He would have made all of us believers. But it's part of the divine plan to give us this choice, and for us to honor this choice and respect this choice and celebrate the diversity in and to respect the individual journey of every human soul as it seeks to know the absolute and to know its creator is part of what we are supposed to encourage. And to thwart the divine plan is certainly not in keeping with any faith tradition, be it Islam or Christianity or Judaism or even atheism.
But are there still plans to build Cordoba House at that site, which is known a little bit wrongly as the Ground Zero site?
I'm working on both possibilities of having it either there or somewhere else at the moment.
And would the somewhere else be very far away or somewhere?
Wherever there's...
It would be in New York.
It would be in the city, yes. So the problem is finding space. I mean, look, I've been a member of this neighborhood of Tribeca since 1983. Mm-hmm. I mean, remember, and, you know, and when 9/11 happened, I mean, we were just as much impacted as the broader community. And in fact, I repeatedly mention, remind my audiences that, you know, 60 Muslims at least have been documented to have been among those the casualties of the 9/11 tragedy. I have stories to tell about people from my community who, there's a lady who lost her only son, who was the joy of her eyes, and she couldn't bring herself to accept that he had died for many months. And she would call me up, and it was a big, big pain for her, very difficult. So we understand the pain of the tragedy. We were part of this tragedy. We were part of the story. But I believe it is important for Muslims to be part of the healing and part of the change. And we're hopeful that that this is recognized and that we will be part of this this new chapter.
In the book, you say that one fear that Muslims have in America is that they don't count as much as Westerners do. And you actually say in the book, here are the questions we ask. Do you remember those questions, or would you like me to throw them at you right here? Because it's very interesting. You're actually saying, here's what Muslims in America ask of themselves and of those of us who are non-Muslims. And the first one is, how many Americans could come close to identifying the correct proportion of Muslims among the total?
Of the population here, you mean?
Yes.
Oh, definitely. But I remember writing that in the context of what happened when my father was held hostage in March of 1977. There was a incident in Washington, D.C., where my father, the Islamic Center, my mother, and the staff of the center was held hostage, together with another group in two other locations, the B'nai B'rith building, and I think the, I forget now, the third location. And the gentleman was a Muslim who held my parents hostage, and my father stared down the barrel of a rifle for 39 hours, and it was because of the involvement of the Muslim ambassadors on the board of trustees who were able to get this whole thing resolved. But in the stories that were written in Time magazine and in other publications, those who died at the B'nai B'rith building or the mayor, he wasn't mayor then. Maren Berry was among those who were wounded, was highlighted, but my parents' story was not. And this is what Muslims feel, is that even, you know, in right now, the majority of the victims of violence are conducted in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Pakistan, are Muslims. In fact, more than 10,000 people, Muslims, die a year from terrorism. So we're the primary victims of such terrorism. And somehow the we don't feel traditionally that the suffering of Muslims or those of us who die are counted. I think, if you don't mind my saying that, I think it's a vestige of the white man's burden, where, you know, that those who were from the West or white, if someone like that happens to him, it's one thing, but our casualties don't count the same way.
I want to ask you about Islam and women. And in this regard, I'm sorry that Daisy Khan, Imam Faisal's wife, who I've met here at the UN several times, could not come tonight. I invited her, but she is busy. She's traveling all the time, I know. So
she's actually at an event at Time Life Books. There's another event that she's invited to tonight. And I represent her here, and she represents me there tonight.
In connection with Islam and women, Daisy, in 2006, set about organizing the first all-female shura, which is, the shura council is the consultation council, in Islamic history. Could you talk a little bit about that? And then I want to go on and ask you about the feminism of the Prophet Muhammad.
Indeed, I have a whole chapter in my book about women and how the history of gender relationships. I mean, I believe that the Prophet, there's no doubt the Prophet for his time was a radical feminist for his time, and did a lot to advance women's rights, so much so that women's rights under Islamic law were in advance of women's rights anywhere else in the world until very recently, until maybe a century ago. But the key thing here is that how do you turn the needle? Everybody wants to know how do you gain traction on turning the needle on any particular issue? The issue of gender relationships is so fraught with culture. It is very strongly cultural, whether you are in the Arab world or whether you're in India or even in pre-modern Europe, it's a very cultural thing. But Daisy has championed, as we all are, a couple of initiatives to combat female genital cutting, FGM, as they call it in Egypt and some other African countries, by looking at the causes, both the religious causes as well as the economic drivers of such things, to change it. We have a very successful project in Egypt, where we actually worked with the midwife who conducted these awful operations and gave her a different line of business to work in. Because even though we convinced her religiously of the fact that this is not required under Islam, it was half of the convincing process. The other half is that, well, she makes a livelihood from this. So unless you give her an alternative livelihood, they can't work. So there was a midwife and a barber in this village that were conducting these things. So the barber wanted, a hot water heater and those big dryers that women sit under for like, half an hour or so. So we invested like $1,500 or $2,500, which is a pittance by our standards, to each of these people. The other lady, the midwife, said, she wants to start a chicken business. And we have helped them. They become prosperous, and they're very proud and happy of this change. Another one is in Afghanistan, where we actually worked with a local imam to educate the people. Because what happens, many people really don't know their religion. I mean, you may think that Muslims know their religion. The problem with Muslims is that Muslims are very passionate about the religion. But they are just as ignorant as Christians and Jews about their own religion. And when you pair passion about your religion with ignorance, that's a dangerous combination. So what we have done in Afghanistan is, with the work of a local scholar, sermons to be given by many of these imams who preach the Friday sermons, and they themselves are not very educated very often on the rights of women, by quoting verse and chapter from the Quran, from the sayings of the Prophet. And we've had very great success with that too. A particular report of one of the people who the NGOs that we partner with to monitor this thing has a story of a person who looked very troubled after the Friday prayer in one of the mosques in Kabul. And he says, "Uncle, can I help?" He says, "No one can help me now." He says, "What happened?" He said, I denied my daughter an education. I consumed her bride price. The bride price, which the bride pray,
the bridegroom prays to the bride under Islamic law is the property of the bride, not the father. I consumed her bride price, and nobody told me this before. Now they're telling me it's too late for me now. So I was very unhappy about it. So it shows that that by creating and crafting strategic projects that we want to hope to scale up now, you can actually advance women's rights very, very powerfully. The other big point is that Islam is a religion of law. And as a religion of law, it's the jurists, it's the people who issue fatwas, which is a legal ruling, that have impact upon the opinion of people. So it's not having a female imam, which is important, as it is having female jurists. And after our initiative, a number of countries in the Arab and Muslim world have actually hired or had people, female muftis, female deputy muftis in Syria. There are two female judges of Sharia law in Palestine. And of course, when this initially happened, it was just like the first time you have a woman on the Supreme Court here. People say, oh my God, you know, what's happening to the world? But this is happening more and more, and we're proud to say, I'm convinced that within the next 10 years, you're going to see massive changes in the Arab and Muslim world on the issue of gender rights.
Including female imams?
Female imams is not that big an issue in the Muslim community, mm-hmm. believe it or not. It's not, I mean, many, see, women are not obliged to go to the mosque for Friday prayers. So if we're not obliged to go to the mosque, you know, you'd rather stay home and do something else. Mm-hmm. The big issue is really other positions of power, women's in ministerial positions as judges issuing fatwas, and that is happening with far more frequency. The issue of female imams will come when it's at the ripeness of its time.
Well, you know, while we're on this subject, something I didn't know that I discovered in the book, and I've now lost it here, it is that Muslim men are permitted to marry what they call believing women among the people of the book, the people of the book being Jews, Christians, and Muslims, without requiring the woman to convert to Islam. In other words, Muslim men permitted to marry believing women among the people of the book without requiring the women to convert to Islam. But the same is not true of Muslim women marrying out of the faith.
Well, traditionally, this has been the position. And traditionally, this is because of a number of reasons, that the man was always the more powerful of the parties. The son would generally take the name of the father, the religion of the father. And also, that because Muslims believe in Jesus and in Moses, I mean, you will never see a Muslim cursing Moses or cursing Jesus. It will never happen, because they are our prophets too. We respect them very deeply. But you will have cases of Jews or Christians who will, like, you know, diss Muhammad, as we say in America, or speak negative about Muhammad. And it's important for a happy married life that there's respect of a person's culture and religion. And I talk about this in the section where I talk about how do we deal with interfaith marriages today. And because of the fact that many Muslim young men marry, you know, Christian or non-Muslim wives, there's a shortage of Muslim men for Muslim girls, and Muslim girls do fall in love with non-Muslim boys. And what do you do, and how do you deal with that? So it's in that context that I mention this point. Although the Quran is silent on this issue, I've discussed how I deal with this issue when it comes to interfaith marriages. Although it is a piece of cake dealing with interfaith marriages between Muslims and Christians. The really tough ones are between Muslims and Hindus. I have a couple of those, actually, several of those that I have conducted myself, which then the stories are very, very emotionally fraught.
I want to go back to Sharia and to something you said earlier, which is the congruence between Islam and democratic lifestyles. In fact, it can be said, Kenneth, that we are all living, I'm not Muslim, I am American, that I am living under Sharia law.
Well, what I'm saying is the whole idea is really the other way around. Is that I'm saying that what I'm saying is that, and I've written a couple of articles about this as well, and I have a whole chapter on Islam State and politics, which I amplify this in a simple language, is that the American social contract, the American Declaration of Independence, expresses values which are completely congruent with Islam and Islamic law. Mm-hmm. Okay, the statement of our Declaration of Independence, which reads, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and property." And property was then edited to pursuit of happiness. These few lines and what comes later expresses the values of Islamic law in very, very powerfully. First of all, the equality of men. The equality of all people is something which really comes from the Abrahamic faith traditions. Because before the Abrahamic faith traditions, whether it's in Egypt, in Rome, in the Far East, people believed in a class or a caste system. And you were born, you lived, you worked, you married, and you died within that particular class. So the equality of man and the king or the emperor or the pharaoh or the Kaiser, the Caesar, was considered semi-divine. The notion of equality of all human beings is something which began and really became very powerful in the Abrahamic faith traditions. And we're combating it even today with class structure and caste structure in many societies. The other thing is that before these words were penned by Thomas Jefferson, and by the way, Thomas Jefferson read the Quran and had Muslim jurists say that all of Islamic law is to further and protect six major overarching objectives. And these objectives are life, honor or dignity. And of course, in Oriental cultures, the concept of honor is a very important concept. Religion, property, family, and the intellect. And what do we do beyond life and liberty? What does the pursuit of happiness mean? What do we do to pursue happiness? We seek property, seek our wealth. We seek to marry our loved ones and have a family and take care of them. We seek our intellectual pursuits, and we seek to practice the faith or the beliefs that we believe in. So then I continue to describe why I say that the American form of governance and the notion of representation, you know, that how and even the notion that the sovereignty under Islamic law lies with God and how this sovereignty is expressed on earth. In fact, I have a project which I have actually done in Malaysia, where I convened about a dozen scholars from various parts of the Muslim world to define what does an Islamic state mean. Unfortunately, I couldn't get this project finished before the Arab Spring began, which is very important for this purpose.
It's not the Sharia Index project? Yes, I wanted to ask you about that.
Yeah.
But it was launched in 2006, yes?
I started it in 2006 with three phases. The first phase was to get a consensus among a cross-section of Muslim scholars, Sunni and Shia, from different countries to agree on what does the notion of Islamic State mean from the point of view of Islamic law and jurisprudence. That we did within about a year after three meetings. This phase two was then to develop a methodology of measuring that definition, because if you can't measure something, it's really meaningless. And that was where we got, because that was where the novelty of the project is and where the cutting ground is. We just achieved breakthrough about a year ago and we finalized the methodology. And then the third part was to develop a rating, an index of nations as to how well they comply with this. And guess what? Western nations, you know, Sweden, United States, Norway, score much higher than Muslim majority countries on many of those line items. So, of course, we can't release a thing saying that Norway is more Islamic than Saudi Arabia. But in a certain sense, it's like saying if Christianity means love thy neighbor, what does a Christian state mean? If it's measured that way, then you measure how well people treat others, and that gives you a rating for how to rate countries based upon the ethics of a particular faith tradition. So based upon the law, of course, they will score less on, let's say, how much their people are praying five times a day or whatever. But on these line items, it depends on how you score them as well. So that was what the project is about. But coming back to the theory behind the project, it's that this country expresses the values of an Islamic state probably as well, if not better, than many, many countries in the world. And this is why I believe our form of democracy has been emulated. I mean, the American Revolution had a huge impact upon not only the French Revolution, which was almost coincident with it, but upon what you might call the transformation of many other countries throughout the world to develop democratic systems that perhaps expressed some aspects of our system of governance, but also did it within their own realpolitik. So let's say in England, they learned from our democracy, but they maintained, let's say, the House of Lords and the House of Commons. So they created a bicameral government in which the noble class still maintained this sharing of power with the common folk, rather than having this different class system.
Can you project that thinking onto what we call the Arab Spring, and particularly Egypt, where we're having an election right now, in which some of the candidates call themselves Islamic. Some of them put forth the idea that they can be Islamic candidates, Islamic parties, like the party in Turkey, for instance, which manages to coexist with ideas of governance and democracy that we would agree with. Is that a way forward in North Africa? Do you see that projection might take hold there?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, democratic principles began in the Muslim world very early, a century ago. I mean, what many people don't realize is that in Egypt in the late 1800s and early 1900s was when the nascent democracy was budding. And, you know, there was the Weft Party, which was the major party in Egypt. And the Weft Party had on its platform Egyptians who are not only Muslims, Egyptian Christians, Copts, and Egyptian Jews as well, were part of those who were candidates as part of the Weft Party. Unfortunately, when Abdel Nasser came, you know, he just eliminated all of that. And it was also, democracy in the Muslim world was a victim of Cold World realpolitik. But with the elimination of the Cold War, the desire of Muslim masses to live in democratic societies is very much the case. And we see it happening. We see it happening in Indonesia, happening in Iran, happening increasingly in the rest of the Muslim world, because this is what the people want.
How did it, I mean, Sharia, as you know, because you're an American, carries this great freighted sense here for Americans, associated with stoning of adulterers and cutting off the limbs of people. How did that happen? It obviously is a gigantic distortion, but how can one combat that?
Well, yeah, by doing things like this. The perception is really about the penal code. And the penal code is applied in very few societies. This penal code of stoning of adulterers and cutting off of hands is really not very much applied. And even in those countries where it's applied to those who are not able to be powerfully represented in the courts. I mean, those in almost every society, those who have political strings or those who are wealthy, politically connected, usually can get away with murder, literally. And this is no less the case in our part of the world. But setting the penal code aside, which I address on how we think we should address it in the modern world, Sharia is very important. It's like saying to ban the Sharia is like banning the Ten Commandments, which is absurd. And many things that we do are in compliance, and there's no problem with it. I mean, let's say, just like Jews have kosher laws, and we have our dietary laws. I conduct weddings, and then I'm licensed by the United States, by the New York State, to conduct weddings. So what are weddings conducted according to Islamic law? They're Sharia-compliant weddings. So the way we eat, the way we pray, the way we I mean, we're allowed, Islamic law, unlike American law, is much more specific on how we dispense of our estates, for example, in our wills. We may not gift more than one third of our estate. At least two thirds of the estate has to be distributed among required beneficiaries, spouses and children, especially. And then it gets more complicated if a person dies without children, then the parents or a sibling may inherit. But there are specific rules on inheritance, which do not contradict American law or Western law. There are rules on custody of in case of a divorce between a husband and a wife of children, particularly if they're male or female, who should go to the father, who should go to the mother. There are laws on these things which do not contradict American law. So for us to abide by Sharia law in the area of personal status law or of all, in fact, all aspects of law, including governance, are not in contradiction with American law or Western law, except for the penal code only.
I just want to mention one more thing. You mentioned Thomas Jefferson knowing the Quran. I think you say in the book, don't you, that Keith Ellison, who is one of the two Muslims in the U.S. Congress from Michigan, I think.
He's from Minnesota.
From Minnesota, okay. Is it?
I think Minnesota.
I'm guilty of that New York, California thing of saying all those states out there. The reason I bring it up is I think you say that when he was sworn in to Congress, that he took his oath of office on Thomas Jefferson's Quran.
Yes, which was
that was news to me.
Yeah,
it was news to me that Thomas Jefferson had a Quran.
A lot of things I knew to a lot of people, which is so amazing about the facts.
Well, it's a reason to read this book. I would love to get some comment questions from the audience, and if you just raise your hand and wait for the microphone to come to you. Here in the second row. And also, if you could identify yourself, please.
Yes, Michelle, you know, the Vogue magazine. When I was a little girl growing up in London, I remember... I don't know what to do about it.
Take this one.
Anyway, can you hear me?
I can hear you, but maybe the others
can't. I should say, by the way, we are webcasting this tonight, which is why it's important that you be heard, because there's a camera back there.
It's a Shirley Lord of Vogue magazine. When I was growing up in London as a little girl, I remember vividly the Aga Khan was much respected. In fact, I think he was weighed in gold every year, and part of he was tremendously respected. Why is it we never hear his descendants' voice? Why is it so quiet and there is no mention anymore of the Aga Khan?
He is certainly mentioned a lot. He's been very active in many positive initiatives. Maybe it's because he's focused mainly on non-controversial issues, health and education and welfare. He's issued an architectural prize, which is very well known, he's been focusing on architecture. He's done a lot of wonderful work in that area in many countries of the world, in Egypt, in Malaysia, and other countries. He's very much respected, but you don't get the news unless there's controversy related to you, as happened to me.
Yes, good evening. My name is Anne Phillips. I'm on the board of IPI, and I want to welcome you to IPI. We're delighted to have you here this evening. I have a question to ask. I am not trying to be provocative. I am not challenging. I'm asking the question truly because I want an answer. That's the reason. As you pointed out, or as we know, the vast preponderance of the Muslim American community is thriving in this country. They are participating productively in the democracy. They are productive human beings in terms of earning a living, in terms of parenting their children, sending them to schools, and so forth. They're thriving here. You pointed out how many tens of thousands of them have been victims of terrorism. What baffles many Americans is, and what I think has a very deleterious effect on the perception of Muslim Americans is the fact that there have been no loud protests or denunciation of terrorist acts. And for instance, well, terrorist acts of which your people, Muslims, have been victimized. Also, when the cartoons in Denmark came out and the violent reaction around the world, there was no voice that came out of Muslim America condemning the behavior. Why is it? The silence, I think, is very destructive, is not helpful to the Muslim American community, which, as I say, is flourishing and participating, and they're Americans and should be speaking out, in my judgment. I think it would be very helpful.
You're very true, and we have condemned that. The problem is that we don't get media attention when we do that. The media does not consider it newsworthy. I mean, I was involved right after 9/11 with a group of Muslim leaders in the city. We had tried to do we actually did a press conference to condemn the events of 9/11 and to declare it has nothing to do with Islam. It didn't get media attention. As I write in my previous book, and I mentioned a couple of stories in my last book, before we went to war in Afghanistan, the U.S. Muslim chaplain, there's a Muslim chaplain in the U.S. Armed Forces, sought for a fatwa as to whether it was okay for Muslims working or serving the armed forces to wage war in Afghanistan, as they would be going fighting against their co-religionists. And this fatwa was, this request for a fatwa went to some of the most important names in the Muslim world, Yusuf Qaradawi, the chief mufti of Egypt, and three other major, major scholars. They issued a fatwa saying that what happened on 9/11 was an act of what's called hiraba in Islamic law, which is considered a capital crime, and that those who conducted it are guilty of this capital crime, and to go after them, even to kill them, is acceptable. I was called by the New York Times to comment on it. At that time, there was a special section in the New York Times called The Nation Challenged, which had all kinds of stories about people who died, families of 9/11. I begged them to put it on the cover of the Nation Challenged. This is a very important news item. Be important not only for American Muslims to see this, but even more important for American non-Muslims to see this is a major fatwa condemning the act of 9/11. And actually declaring that American Muslims serving the American armed forces can actually wage war against the people who conducted this event. I begged them to put in the front cover of The Nation Challenged. It was buried on page B8. It was very difficult for us for the important news items to, as a friend of mine said, if it doesn't bleed, it doesn't lead. And this has been my predicament, our predicament. If I were to stand on a soapbox and say, we Muslims should kill all Christians and Jews, boy, I would be on the front news of everything. But when we condemn the acts of terrorism, when we speak about moderation, it's very hard to get the media attention. Now, I have worked with media people. I say, if you have any ideas on how we can expand and amplify this voice, let's do so. And what's pleasing to me and gratifying to me is that the Prime Minister of Malaysia, the current Prime Minister of Malaysia, has actually agreed to champion a notion of the global movement of moderates. And he launched a conference in January of this year in Malaysia, in Kuala Lumpur, championing this idea. But again, it's difficult to get international media attention. So we're working to see how we can build a growing, snowballing movement of people who believe in the principles of moderation, and little by little, I believe we're winning the war. Little by little, people know that Islam is not the enemy, that terrorism is the enemy, that terrorism is a common enemy, that it's the enemy of all of us. And we also, more and more people in positions of power have moved away from the notion that Samuel Huntington really proposed, that there's a clash of civilizations and we want to have a different paradigm. It's absurd, as I point out in the book. Never in human history has any political regime waged war against religion and won. The Romans tried to liquidate Christianity. After three centuries, Rome became the capital of the capital of the Roman Catholic Church. The Soviets tried to liquidate religion. Communism is now, you know, a thing of the past, and all the religions are coming back. The Nazis tried to destroy Judaism by conducting, you know, the worst genocide in human history, and they didn't succeed. So it is absurd to think that the United States should wage or can wage, or any regime, even the secular, non-anti-religious regimes like Ataturk in Turkey or Abd Nasser in Egypt or the Shah of Iran, who basically marginalized the religious voices. Those regimes have ended with the result that a more strident religiosity has come back, and you see it in all of these countries. So moderation is the way to go, and moderation is the way that we have to keep the balance, because whatever you call yourself, whether you're secular, whether you're religious, whether you're Muslim, whether you're Jew, whether you're atheist, it's in the middle ground that we can find the common ground and the agreement.
Saul? Actually, we'll take two questions. Saul first, and then young woman in the back. Three. Good. Well, as a matter of fact, we have four. Saul first, woman there, this gentleman here, and finally, Kai.
Thank you very much. My name is Saul Weisleder. I am from the mission of Costa Rica to the UN. It is really a pleasure and very inspiring to listen to you and what you say. So thank you very much for that.
My pleasure.
Now, I'd like to ask a question, as the lady said, to try to understand. First of all, let me say that I don't think that the enemy is terrorism. I think terrorism is the extreme enemy. But I think the enemy is the difficulty of living together, of finding a way to live in together with different cultures or conceptions or whatever. But anyway, if one defines moderate, one doesn't have to define, but you have your own definition, which I think we all share, or at least I share, without exactly having to know how it is. What proportion do you think that, for example, of, and I am going to use a word, and it doesn't, it's not intended to be, I hope it's correctly used. What proportion of, let's say, Egypt clerics would you define as moderate? That's one question. And the other question is, you are very well received here. What has been your experience as a religious leader with non-moderate Muslim clerics? Sorry, again, sometimes the word cleric is not well received, but it doesn't mean I can't find another one. So I think you understand what I mean. Thank you. Yes.
Okay, hold that thought. I'm going to get the other three questions and gather them. Young woman in the back.
Hi, my name is Jessica Bain with Columbia University. Thanks so much for speaking with us tonight. My question also involves the theme of moderation, and in particular the word moderate. I'm reminded of a quote from Pamela Geller, anti-Muslim bigot on the internet, who said, "The only moderate Muslim is a secular Muslim." And I'm wondering how to counter this perception that religiosity somehow coincides with violent politics, and that moderation might apply both to religiosity as well as politics. Is there a different word that we could use that might better reflect the more nuanced definition of moderation that you described in Arabic?
Thank you. Gentleman here.
Thank you. My name is Mohammed. I'm an intern here at the UN. I have two short questions. My first question is, why do the word moderation or moderate only implied with the person is a Muslim? I have never heard about Christian moderate or Jewish moderate person. but only when it comes to Muslim. And my second question is, do you think that we can disconnect the issue of the Muslim living, for example, in the US, and the American foreign policy in the Muslim world?
And then finally, Kai.
Thank you, Imam. I've already browsed a little bit in your book. It's interesting, and being Norwegian, apparently I am then the most compliant Muslim in the room with Sharia, according to what you said earlier. So what I'm asking about, and what I really want to know about, is if women in our countries, in the Scandinavian countries, have so many more rights, and this is one of the reasons why we're prosperous, how do you try and sell this idea of moderation when you travel and when you engage? Because having been in the Middle East a lot, I find it to be very hard, and also not being Christian, I find the misogyny in Christianity hard to accept. And I think, you know, looking at the Vatican, it's they're misogynistic heaven, and then we have Saudi Arabia, which is also misogynistic and very much so mentioned. Also in your book, you mentioned Saudi Arabia is the only country where women don't drive a car, etc. How do you challenge these notions, and how do you shake those things? Because I think those are the things that are hard for us who see it.
Yes, a friend of mine did actually, let me just take very quickly a brief response to that, who did some polling in Saudi Arabia and discovered that women don't want, many women don't want this ruling. No, because right now they have drivers. You see, because they don't allow to drive, the husband is required to hire a driver, and many women would rather have a driver rather than drive themselves, because you have to look for parking. It's more inconvenient, you know. So many women don't want this ruling, surprisingly, overturned, because then many of them will lose their drivers and have to drive themselves. So it's interesting how certain things are perceived some way by some of us and are perceived differently by what is deemed to be a majority of women. I don't know when the poll was conducted, I think a couple of years ago. So what appears to us as one thing does not appear necessarily the same way to someone else. I know the word moderation is not the perfect of words, but it is a placeholder we're using for the time being. But moderation is about moderation in behavior, not moderation in beliefs. It's also about moderation in terms of our policies, as one of the questioners pointed out. Much of the issues that are seen as driving the conflict, I mean, in fact, when I started an initiative after 9/11 called the Cordoba Initiative to combat or to bridge U.S.-West or U.S.-Muslim relations, which has actually evolved into West-Muslim relations. And what I did was I looked at the categories which are fueling what people regard as Muslim-West problems or friction. And we divided them into four categories or four buckets of problems. They're not firewall, but they are a kind of a combination of all of these. Most importantly is the political conflicts. As I point out to people, you know, you'll find people attacking American interests, not Canadian interests or French interests. Why? Because it's American foreign policy that many people in the Muslim world are upset about. The biggest problem and the most longest standing problem is the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But also we have a very heavy footprint, the Iraq invasion of Iraq and Afghanistan, and the very heavy footprint that we have in the Muslim world, bases in many Muslim countries. And this is the reason why there is this tension. The second, which exists in Europe as well, is the issue of social identity. Muslims in this country, as Anne pointed out, tend to be more highly educated, tend to be professional class, tend to be better integrated, also in part because America's social contract is structurally multicultural. We're all immigrants in this country. Whereas Europe, to my eyes, or in my eyes, is evolving from a monocultural paradigm to a multicultural paradigm. Not only within Europe, you know, how Europe itself is, you know, Spain has more retired people now from England coming and buying retirement homes in Spain or Portugal because of the weather, just like people here move to Florida or to Arizona to retire. We see the same things happening in Europe. So Europe is changing from a monocultural paradigm to a multicultural paradigm, including people from outside Europe. And that's the issue of identity, and people who don't feel engaged or welcomed feel marginalized. These are some of the issues which are faced. And also then we have the issue of perception, which is shaped by the media. Until 9/11, the media was always showing Muslims as terrorists. Entertainment media, film media would show Muslims as being terrorists. Just like when I was growing up, I would see, you know, Western films showing the native Indians as being savages and their lives could be just knocked off. Or the Tarzan movies, you know, where the blacks are considered savages. This didn't become politically correct by the 70s. Whereas the Muslims were what Hollywood was a free hit. This is an example I remember the 60s, it was always Muslim terrorists, the Christian phalangists, or Christian freedom fighters. But those who are Muslims were not considered freedom fighters, they were considered terrorists. So the association of language that we use maintains perceptions. So we need to develop projects in the media, solve the political problems, solve the problem of identities in certain societies. And also there's also a category of what I call the theological or religious problems, like church-state relations in Islam, like the niqab in France and the hijab, that kind of stuff. So if we address all these things, then that's how we solve the problem. It's like it's no more complicated than a corporate turnaround. Of course, it's more complicated because we're dealing with what we might call social engineering, or developing, you know, communities and societies. But I think it's something which is certainly doable. The timeline is longer. It'll happen within the timeline of a generation, half a generation, two generations. But I believe that I'm optimistic about the future. I believe that we have gained a lot of ground in the last 10 years, 11 years, since we began this work. We have helped shift the discourse about Islam in this country and Islam in Europe. Through my writings and books, and I mean, just one voice. But I think, you know, we have been able to have a multiplier effect as people take the ideas which have merit and build on it and take it even further. And I'm very optimistic about the future.
Well, on that uplifting note, we will come to an end. Imam Feisal will stay here to sign books. The bar remains open. And please stay well. Thank you very much for your attention, for coming, and thank you in particular, Imam Feisal, for coming to IPI.
Thank you so much.